motor running. Head out on the highway, looking for adventure. And whatever comes our way, yeah, darling, go make it happen. Take the world in a loving place. Fire all of the guns and pumps and explode into space. I like smoking lightning, heavy metal thunder, racing with the wind.
And I'm happy to present the Nirvana F200 Long Range XE. Now shut up, because the visuals do all the talking. Isn't this just the most magnificent machine ever? All right, the 200cc, it puts out a lot of power. The lighting's pretty bad here, but focus on this. Here is carbon fiber secondary tank. So this thing is super sweet. As it stands here, it's not the kind of machine that you leave on your porch overnight, because by the time you get there in the morning, all the animals will be humping it. It's just so beautiful. It's magnificent. It's perfect. I gotta fly it, obviously, and this is what I'm gonna do now. I'm actually nervous because this is one of a kind as it stands here. These tanks aren't mass produced. It's the first prototype that's on the machine. It will get a little bit refined once the tanks come out in about 10 days' time. But the test I'm going to be doing now is crucial. I'm going to fly the hell out of it to make sure I can find all the fault with it. All right, so let's get into the flying and then we do the rest. All right, so perfect first flight. I'm over the moon with this design. I can just imagine the possibilities for us from now on when it comes to XE racing. But also, if you've got to do really long flights, the fact that you now have the capability on a super lightweight machine. And it's very different. It's very different from the other concepts, which are, you know, let's just take, there's only two machines really on the market now, which has two brands at least that have tried to solve this problem. It's Parajet with the Maverick and Nirvana with the F-Light. This tank is not available, will not be available to the other Nirvana models. So with Parajet's design, it was quite simple for them because the tank straps onto, it's a releasable tank, so it straps onto, so they can just swap tanks, go from a small tank to a big tank whenever they do long range flights. But whenever you do something that is a quick solution, you have to expect that it might not be the 100% perfect solution. So with Nirvana, when I said to him, are you going to do the same for us? Are you going to give us a bigger size tank that goes into the skeleton from the bottom? Because, you know, it makes sense. You can just make it wider, bigger, take it from 10 liters to 15 to 16, 17 liters if you have to. It isn't even possible to get it up to 20 liters. But they said no. The reason why they said no was because of the aerodynamics. That's a big thing for Nirvana, because their machines are wind tunnel tested. Nobody else does that. So they were trying to get something that would work with the current airflow of the machine, and therefore you'll see it kind of gels. It doesn't stick out above like some of the first prototypes that were made. And yeah, it's a bit of a, there's still some sealant and some rough, I wouldn't say it's not perfect finishing touches, but the tanks that are coming out in 10 days will be perfect. All right, so for them it was aerodynamics. And secondly, if you had a 25 liter tank or a 20 liter tank, but it's all in one tank, you can imagine that that weight is all at the bottom. Now, low center of gravity is not a bad idea, but as soon as that tank's not full, you get a sloshing effect, meaning you move one way and the fuel's moving the other way, and therefore when you're running, it's not an ideal situation for a pro pilot. It could be it's not the worst possible thing to have to deal with. So yeah, that's pretty much where Parajet has gone with their design. Nirvana always tries to go a step further. That's just the way, that's their style. These scientists, the mechanics and aviation experts that work at that R&D department just always want to do something better. And it looks like a tank that's just straps onto the outside, but it's not, because it goes inside the skeleton. It fills up all the little small volumes of little open spaces. One thing that Nirvana doesn't have, and probably we'll be discussing that with them this week, is a fuel management system. How are you gonna work the piping between the top tank and the bottom tank? Now that is, for me, I said to him, I'm gonna use my own system, because it took me a long time and a couple of Icaruses to figure out how best to manage different tanks you're gonna use. And it's not that difficult. All right, so what I've done is, the main tank, you've got your connection over there, and currently you got to get from the top tank to the main tank. Now what I have here is I've got a blue shut-off valve, which means I can isolate the top tank from the bottom tank. Currently it's in an isolated position. I have to open up the valve here, and the fuel flow is now open to go into the main tank. If I wanted to shut this off for any reason, and this comes back from my aviation days, from my fixed wing piloting days, you always want the capability to isolate situations. So if there's a problem with the top tank, I could cut the fuel flow off for it in flight. It's not too difficult. I can reach around. I could extend this piping. I could make it a bit more. That's obviously going to be worked out with trial and error. I can isolate the top tank from the bottom tank. And also, if you've isolated the top tank, then you're going to get the bottom tank's not going to depressurize. You see over there, you need a little valve because of the suction that comes out from the bottom tank, you know, from the system that wants to suck up the fuel into the carburetor. If it's a closed system, it's going to choke out and the engine's going to die. You need a small little valve, and my solution is to put in an air valve over here. So as soon as I isolate the top tank, then I open up the air valve over here, and the bottom tank is able to suck air from that valve, and then you can keep flying. Now that usually worked with fuel bags. Now what is the advantage? Currently in most races you're not going to do more than 5 hours, so I reckon I've got about a 5 hour range with this machine as it is now. I still got to make sure 100% about what the volume is here, but you're looking around 15-16 liters in total between the two tanks. That is more than enough for a situation where if I could have that kind of fuel capacity and I don't need extra bladder bags hanging in front of me, in the back of me, and cables everywhere. In actual fact, what happened with the Icarus X was the pilot that took off in front of me, right in front of me. I was right at the back of the queue. I had to move all the way back. I'm taking off on a long runway, and I was right in the front, and I had to move all the way back because I saw rotor coming over my spot, and I thought I might blow my Icarus again. So I moved all the way to the back, and the guy that took off right in front of me grabbed the prop, chopped his bladder pipe, had went in, chopped it. Apparently it shot some part of the pipe right through the glider as well, and he had a magnificent crash right in front of me. So piping and complexities and fuel bags and bladder bags and fuel tanks and all that kind of stuff, if you can lessen all the stuff that you carry, if you can make it less complex, easier to work with, then you're going to have fun. You're going to have fun in these long-range races, and maybe a bit of a compromise on having super long range is the way to go. But let's say I have to go super long range. Then all I do is I take the fuel cap off at the top, and I fit the same kind of one that goes on here with a pipe that comes over onto to a bladder bag. It's all about creating, for me, it's all about creating the ultimate conservation tool. And we're one step closer. Well, actually, we're almost there. I can almost taste it. The last thing that's going to come from this machine. Anyone's trying to fish out what is the next and last. There's only one more thing that's going to come to the F-Light before I'm done. Before I'm done moaning and screaming at Nirvana for creating the ultimate machine, because it's about me, I'm the most annoying person in the world for them, because I keep on yelling for more. I'll test it for you. I'll put in the hours. I'll make sure it works. I'll give you the feedback. But you just got to produce the solutions. And the last thing that they're going to do now is, and they're already done with it, it's coming out in 10 days, that is putting the reserve chute under the seat. So it's pretty much the same as the Ranger and the Instinct. I thought that design was brilliant. I don't know why it was never introduced with the F-Light. But now that brings me back to the last point. The F-Light was never designed as a racing machine. It was never designed as the ultimate Ranger machine. It was never designed as the ultimate military machine. But by pure accident, it just turned out to be the absolute best thing. You know, the best thing since buttered bread. All right, I hope you guys enjoyed the video.